Thank you, sir, for your inspirational thoughts. May I now request Dr. H.P. Kanoria to kindly felicitate Sri Pradeep Bhattacharya.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
I would now like to call upon Sri Sitaram Sharma, Chairman West Bengal Federation of United Nations Association and Honorary Council of the Republic of Belarus in Kolkata, to kindly give us his discourse.
Distinguished speakers and friends, as Maharaj Ji rightly said in the beginning, that today is a day to remind us about the values. And I think we need this reminder constantly. In a country like India, we have our scriptures, our saints to provide us the values. Today we find, in fact I would like to say that I find myself closer to what Sri Pradeep Bhattacharya said. Because when Rahul Verma was speaking, I was thinking that we are in an ideal world, but let us accept that we don't live in an ideal world. Can you believe, can you think of it fact that in a country of Lord Rama and Prahlad, the government of India has had to enact a law to force the children to look after their parents? So our values has come down to that level. Despite having discourses, satsangs, a number of saints and sadhus all over the country, and having 24/7 channels, number of channels with religious discourses, our values, both moral and social values, are declining. Families are disintegrating. What do you find in the society today? In a family, irrespective of who is the elder brother, the richest brother is the elder brother. What does it convey to us? Money speaks, money counts in our society. This influence of money in the society has led to decline of the social and the moral values. I think that we need a lot of changes in our society. And for that, basic changes will have to take place. The morality, the lack of morality we find in all aspects of our life, be it in the business, be it in the public life, be it in the social life. And because of that, our society is suffering. I'm very happy that the World Values Day is being observed, and so that we are reminded of the values and we do our best efforts to preserve these values in our country, in our society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your kind thoughts with us. May I now request Dr. H.P. Kanoria to kindly felicitate Sri Sitaram Sharma. I would now like to invite Professor Dr. Shruranjan Das, Vice Chancellor, Jadavpur University, Kolkata. He is also an honorary director of the Netaji Institute of Asian Studies in Kolkata. So may I request you to kindly share your thoughts on values.
Distinguished panelists, esteemed members of the House, could I first say a big thank you to the organizers of this session for inviting me and be a part of the celebration of the World Values Day. I need not take much of your time because first time is running short and much of the things have already been touched upon by my preceding speaker. That is one of the benefits when you become the last speaker. I would however like to proceed from the points where Honorable Mr. Pradeep Bhattacharya ended and Mr. Sitaram Sharma extended those points further. I do appreciate the point that Mr. Pradeep Bhattacharya made about the relationship between hunger, poverty and the lack of values. But I'd like to little differ from him in saying that that is not always the case. Ajke amader deshe sobtheke orthoniti sobtheke boro oporadhi kintu boro lokera. আজকে সবথেকে বড় ডিফল্টাররা কিন্তু ইন্ডাস্ট্রিয়ালিস্টরা। আজকে যে কটা বড় বড় করাপশন কেস হয় তার মধ্যে উচ্চবর্গীয় মানুষরাই কিন্তু বেশি ইনভলভড। কাজে এটা হয়তো সবসময় বলা যায় না যে গরিব হলেই তাকে ভ্যালু ওরিয়েন্টেশন দেওয়া যাবে না বা বড়লোক হলেই তাকে ভ্যালু ওরিয়েন্টেশন দেওয়া যাবে না। আমি যেভাবে দেখি in the realm of values, there are certain universal norms, certain universal norms of virtues which cuts across time. Of course, the notion of values changes over a period of time. But there are certain universal values which have been time tested and which needs to be inculcated among all sections of the society in order to create a better world to live in. So that was the first point that I wanted to make. I do believe that there are certain sections of the Indian society, and unfortunately they come from the upper social strata, who have been so affected by the force of globalization that they are increasingly tending to be individualistic, consumerist, failing to think of others, failing to think of the society and failing to think of the nation. I'll give you one or two quick examples for that. I have a 17-year-old daughter who used to go to a wonderful kindergarten school in Salt Lake. I live in Salt Lake. When she was young, I used to go every day to collect my daughter from the school. One day I was standing in the queue to collect my daughter, and in front of me was a mother. Obviously she was from a very well-to-do family. The girl comes out, it was summer. The girl complained to the mother, "Mom, the teachers haven't allowed us to play in the garden." So the mother said, "Why should the teacher allow you? Because it's summer, there's heat." Prompt came the answer from the girl, "Why can't they air condition the playground?" I am not blaming the girl. I am blaming the particular way in which children today are bred, are brought up, particularly in the well-to-do sections of the society. How do we instill the values in them? They do not come from the poor sections. We live in a pluralist society in India. And in the name of globalization, in the name of interaction with the outside world, very often we tend to forget our rich cultural pluralistic heritage, which today needs to be strengthened and sustained. When we were young, when we started reading, we started with Rabindranath, we started with Vivekananda, we started with Premchand, we started with Shukanta, we started with Nojul. But today, when a child starts reading, he or she starts with Spider-Man and Harry Potter. I am not against Harry Potter or Spider-Man. But I draw the kind attention of the house to a small news item that was published last year. When an 8-year-old child trying to imitate Spider-Man jumped from the first floor veranda of his house and lost his life. I give this example to show that values need to be constantly instilled and recreated. Of course, we should keep the doors and windows of our house open so that fresh air can come and make us think afresh. But we cannot put ourselves in a situation where the fresh air coming through the doors and windows can unsettle the foundation of our house. But we are faced with this cultural challenge today. When I go abroad, I find the children rereading Shakespeare, rereading Chaucer, rereading Shelley, rereading Keats, rereading Charles Dickens. But are we sure? We have been able to instill under a youth the values that we have received from our forefathers who had created the foundations of a very culturally pluralist, thriving society. We often forget that Indian culture as we see today does not represent one particular strand. Indian culture is assimilative. Indian culture is syncretic. It is an amalgamation of various traits: Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Zoroastrianism, Islam, Christianity. And therefore, from the very beginning, we have seen the imprint of what is now called the other culture. In 6th century BC, there was a Persian invasion, and after that invasion, there was a very strong Persian imprint on the architecture that was developed in the Mauryan period. Today, we are proud of the Gandharo art, but we very often forget that Gandharo art had a very strong Greek and Hellenistic influence. With the Muslims came a new cultural strand which led to the development of the Indo-Islamic architecture. The best example of which is the Taj Mahal. We are all proud of the Indian classical music, but we very often forget that the two essential prerequisites of Indian classical music, tabla and sarangi, were brought by the Muslims. Similarly, we speak of the Rajasthani style of painting. We often forget that the Rajasthani style of painting is an amalgam of the Western Jaina tradition and the Islamic influence. It is true, during the rule of the Muslim rulers, there was the patronage of the Persian. But we also forget some of the best masterpieces of Sanskrit were produced during the medieval period. During the medieval period again, you had the convergence of various forms of religion to the Bhakti movement, to the Sufi movement. And then came Christianity, which enabled us to develop a melting pot between the East and the West, which enabled India to move towards modernity. So Indian culture, Indian civilization has bred in us, has a tradition of pluralistic values. Swamiji spoke of pluralism. And time has come to ensure and strengthen this pluralism in our life, irrespective of a person who comes, whether he or she comes from the upper social strata or the lower social strata. Those are the universal values which need to be developed. I am reminded here of a very pertinent saying of the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi. As early as 1936, he remarked, and I quote, "No culture can live if it attempts to be exclusive. There is no such thing as pure Aryan culture in existence in India today. whether the Aryans were indigenous to India or were unwelcome intruders, does not interest me much. What does interest me is the fact that my remote ancestors blended with one another with the utmost freedom, and we of the present generation are result of that blend, unquote. What a wonderful saying, as early as 1936. And that saying, I think, is becoming particularly relevant today when the need is to strengthen cultural pluralism in our country, and that is one of the values that need to be imbibed. Of course, it's a very difficult task. But let me remind ourselves again of a pertinent saying of Swami Vivekananda, and I quote, take up one idea, make that idea of your life, dream of it, think of it, live on that idea. Let the brain, the body, muscles, nerves, every part of your body be full of that idea, and just leave every other idea alone. This is the way to success, and this is the way great spiritual giants are produced, unquote. I think that should be the guiding spirit of inculcating one of the basic values necessary for the survival of India, the value of cultural pluralism and the value of toleration. In 1937, Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore delivered the convocation address in the University of Calcutta. And for the first time in the history of the University of Calcutta, the convocation address was delivered in Bengali. And this is what Tagore reminded us. I quote, Nije Sreshtota Darai Onne Sreshtota Kamra Jagate Pari Tatei Mongol Amader O Onner. That sums up the spirit of toleration of which Swami Shupananandaji reminded us. And that is one of the basic values that we need to inculcate today to create a better India to live in. With these words, would I once again congratulate the organizers for organizing this session and inviting me to this session, and I wish the panel discussions every success. I am particularly impressed by the fact that the students have been involved in this session, because only when students and youth are involved, a session like this can have a multiplier effect. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, sir, for your inspirational thoughts. May I now request Dr. H.P. Kanoria to kindly felicitate Dr. Suranjan Das. May I now request our eminent speakers to kindly take their seats in the audience in preparation of the panel discussion. I would also like to request Mr. Calvert, Dr. Hart, and Mr. Amalir to kindly remain seated. I would also like to invite Mr. Anish Agarwal and Ms. Shalini Das to kindly come up to the stage. Before we begin our discussion, I would like to introduce our distinguished panelists. Mr. Michael Sheen Calvert is member of the Legislative Assembly of West Bengal. Besides representing the Anglo-Indian community, he has been involved with education for over 3 decades. Dr. Gillian Hart, the Director of Education, CEO and Honorary Secretary of Welland Goldsmith Schools, Kolkata. Dr. Hart has served in educational institutions for the entire duration of her professional career and contributed immensely to the education of children. Mr. Stéphane Amalur is the director of Alliance Francaise du Bengal in Kolkata. Mr. Anish Agarwal is a student of St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. And Ms. Shalini Das is a student of Bethune College, Kolkata. I would now like to request Mr. Michael Calvert to kindly take over the panel discussion.
At the outset, I'd like to say how privileged I am to be here on this wonderful occasion of World Values Day, the launching of World Values Day. And it's a privilege to be here to speak before such an erudite audience. And we've heard plenty of speakers, very eminent speakers, who've come up here and who've had so much to say. You know, just I'm reminded of what Professor Suranjan Das had mentioned, that, you know, speaking at the end is a good thing, because when you have too many speakers, so many speakers having to say so much at the beginning, it leaves nothing much to be said. What do you think is my position? I'm speaking immediately after Professor Suranjan Das. Thank you to all the wonderful speakers who've been up here and who have elaborated and expounded on this wonderful topic of values. I think it's important for us to understand that values, from my point of view, values is not getting eroded. There is no erosion of values. It is either our appreciation of values and learning to implement them and put them into action, or it is our lack of appreciation of values and discarding them and not making them a part of our lives. That's my belief. Values has always been there. Whether you talk about honesty, you talk about integrity, you talk about obedience and so on and so forth, it's all there. It is for us to be able to accept and follow these values in our lives. It is our thoughts and actions. If our thoughts and actions are aligned, we will then be better individuals, we will be a better society, we will be better people, and humanity in the long run will benefit. I'm reminded of a little story. I don't want to speak too much because, you know, I'll end up giving advice, and you know what happened to Socrates? You remember Socrates? Yes? He went around giving people advice, and what did they do to him? They poisoned him. So I'll desist from that. There was this very rich person who led a very wealthy, luxurious life, and after many years he felt that it was time to relax and enjoy his the success that he had earned, to enjoy the comforts and luxuries that he had been able to acquire. And so he decided that this is time for me to put up my boots and hang up my boots and relax and enjoy all that I have. And unfortunately, the angel of death decided to visit him at that point in time. And so he found that he was not going to be able to use or enjoy all that he had worked hard for. And then he decided that he's going to try and, you know, barter with the angel of death and said, look, could you please give me a little more time? I need some more time. I need to enjoy all that I've acquired, this wealth, this luxury, the happiness, and so on and so forth. I mean, let me enjoy all this. And the angel of death refused, point blank. I'm sorry, your time has come. You've got to go. And being a very shrewd businessman, he said, all right, give me 24 hours. You know, 24 hours, just 24 hours, that's it. I don't want any more time. And the angel of death said, well, I'm sorry, I can't give you 24 hours. That's it, you've got to go. realized that the angel of death was not really going to relent in this case. So he said, all right, give me 1 hour. Give me 1 hour. And even then the angel of death said, sorry, not 1 hour. All right, give me 1 minute. Just 1 minute. And the angel of death said, all right, I'll give you 1 minute, and just this 1 minute. Well, what do you want this 1 minute for? And he said, I want to spend this 1 minute saying my goodbyes to the people that I know. Just 1 minute to say goodbye. And the angel of death said, all right, I'll give you this 1 minute. And during that 1 minute, this gentleman sat and wrote his goodbye. And this is what he wrote. Spend your time, which was given to you, in the right way. I couldn't buy even an hour of life with all my wealth. Listen to your heart and check if the things surrounding you have a true value. Cherish every minute of your life. Ladies and gentlemen, dear students and friends, I think that's what's most important for all of us, to be able to cherish the good things in life, learn to appreciate them, and let us learn to make a very happy and a better society. Now, if I go on, my colleagues on the dais will probably start flinging their mics at me. So what I shall do is to request each of you to maybe just say a few words if you have to. If you can go ahead and say more than just a few words, if you have more than that. And what I'll do is maybe I'll ask you a question sometime if there is. And then if there are any questions that you may have from among the audience, students, if you're still awake after my little talk, you're most welcome to ask questions. All right. Maybe begin with, age. Two ladies on stage. We'd like to start with the lady, but I'll give age preference. All right, is that fine by you? All right, Dr. Hart, you've been in this world of education for, how many years? Three, four, five decades? A long, long time. I mean, she's been in this as a teacher. No, I don't want you to try and guess the age. I mean, you'll never get it right. She's been as a teacher, as an administrator. Tell me, what has been your experience as an administrator in all these years of experience, first as a teacher and then as an administrator? Have you seen a shift in values? Do you think there is a shift in values? I mean, you can go ahead and make a comment first and then answer the question.
I shall try and do both, Mr. Calvert. First of all, at the outset, let me tell all of you that I belong to a unique and most understanding generation. Mr. Calvert has already more or less aged me because he's told you that I've been 5 decades as a teacher and administrator. Those of my generation, we listened to and we tried our best to follow the values that were taught to us by our parents and teachers. Today, I'm part of that generation and also part of the generation who now have to listen to our children. Therefore, I think I'm a limited edition. Most of my generation have been brought up by parents and teachers of yesteryears. We are all products of the old-fashioned parents and old schools of thought. And yet I'm sure all of you will agree that we've done pretty well in life thanks to those same parents and teachers who taught us values. An important value being, train up a child in the way that he or she will go. And when he or she is old, they will not depart from it. Yes, the winds of change keep blowing stronger with each gust, and all of us willy-nilly are swept along with them. We are caught up in the rat race of modern times, where life is faster and more demanding, and like it or not, it's a dog-eat-dog world we are living in. Competition is now the name of the game. I think Mr. Rahul Verma told us this during his presentation. There's, as an educationist, I find that there's a constant need to keep up with the Joneses. My son has 8 tutors and studies 12 to 14 hours a day and repeatedly scores above 90% in maths and science. Young people here, do you think this is a value to be emulated? Well, we are going to be discussing that over the next half an hour or so. One of the values that I also learned or knew about, of course, is that silence is golden, and Mr. Rahul Verma also told us to listen. He said we should listen rather than talk, so I think I'm not going to talk very much more. But to your question whether I have seen a change or shift in values over the years, yes, I definitely have witnessed a change in values over the last half century. First of all, childhood has been cut short. Studies begin in earnest today from the age of 2.5 years as compared to 5 years or so earlier. Schools used to be places of fun and, you know, fun learning, but today they have become nothing more than a mere toll gate on the road to financial success. Parents today feel that the sooner their children are fitted out for the fast track, the better. Children are fashioned to become the fittest to survive, blissfully ignorant of the risk of an early burnout. Children of today have so much more to do, but no space to do it in, no space to run around, play games and things like that. And that, I feel, leads to further frustration. Is there a remedy for all this? Yes, the remedy is to give our children love and to lead by example. Parents and teachers, we have a more dynamic role to play today. Young people, what do you do to stop the bombardment of young minds and ensure that we pass on the correct moral and social values? We have to come together, cooperate. We must be patient and make whatever time we have with our children count. Give children quality time rather than material compensation. These are some of the remedies that I think, some of the values that we should inculcate. And this is my experience over these many years. Now it's up to you. And of course, Mr. Calvert will get it out from you whether you agree with me or not. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ma'am. If you remember when Mr. Rahul Verma was giving us the presentation, right at the beginning, there was a nice little quote there, and I liked it, so I wrote it down. And does anyone remember what it was? Rahul, not you, please. No, you can't. You can't answer this question. Anyone remember? Do you remember what was it in there?
There were many quotes.
There was one right at the beginning. It said, putting values at the heart of the world. I think that is what, you know, basically what ma'am was trying to tell us, putting values at the heart of the world. And when she spoke about, you know, materialistic and so on and values, I think one of the problems is that we know the price of things. Everybody seems to know the price of things. But how many of us actually knows the value of it? I think we need to ask ourselves, this question from time to time. All right, is there anyone who wants to ask ma'am a question? Or are you happy with me moving to the lady right at the end? Is there anyone? Yes, sir.
Why can't we make the education such that the child, after learning it, cannot do any harm to anything? He enjoys the life, and then he does not do any harm, and he gives the truth and love suddenly. That is, it becomes impossible for him to do anything wrong. Why we cannot make such a good model of education?
Well, sir, that would be the ideal, definitely, where we have a world where educators teach children that they should only do good and not do wrong. But it's not only the educators and the schools that have an influence on the child. No doubt, we are there right from the beginning. But it is other, so many other factors also influence a child. Once they grow up, once they go out into the world, they learn so many other things which also influence them. But I do agree with you that whatever we can do as educators, as institutions, as schools, we should do, and that is what we are trying to do very much in our schools today. I don't think we should have a subject of value education or moral science as such, but we should teach it through the subjects that we teach. Through Indian history, we teach about our country, about the culture. Through geography, we teach how we can learn to live together and be together. Maths helps us to teach a child about integrity, honesty. These are the ways in which we should do it. This is my own feeling. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. If I can just add to that, just add is that, look, yes, schools play a very vital, very important role in helping children and to inculcate values. But do understand that society, to a large extent, also exerts its influence. And that's what ma'am was trying to say, that it's not just the responsibility of schools. It is the responsibility of humanity at large. And that is, that, puts the onus on each one of us at whichever point of time we are, whichever stage of our lives we may be, we are all individually and yet collectively responsible for the values which we either learn to appreciate and inculcate, or we say, right, keep this away from us, we are not interested in following it. All right. Okay, we'll now move to this young lady from Bethune College, Ms. Shalini Das. Would you like to make a comment and then I'll ask you? Or
you can ask me a question.
You sure? Do you have anything? Okay, tell me, what is your opinion of values?
Good evening to the respectable dignitaries present here. I've been asked to give a comment on my opinion on values. Well, I think that I've written it down. So, for me, values are like the reflections in a kaleidoscope. They change. We change in perspective, which leads to a conflict of interest for sure. But I would like to say that, well, we may say that values do not validate us, but they surely make us a better person. But we can say that what is a right value, that's a sensitive issue. The whole definition of a right deed is a relative term. What may look like 9 to me may look like a 6 to another. So, as in the beginning of the session it has been said that the right deed is a relative thing. So we may say that I would like to give an example. Like, at the first instance, we may say that anything illegal may seem unethical to us, but there are examples where, due to compulsions and necessity, one may have taken to illegal processes, as they are victims of the obstacles on the right path. Like, we may say that a terrorist is a freedom fighter to another. So therefore, as you had asked Madam Hart, we can say that the values are not absolute and constantly shifting, changing with difference in meaning and context. Change is impedant in everyone's life. Some accept and adapt, or reject and regret later. And thus, this development in different perspectives have resulted in rejection of values, that one should be flexible and open to various subjugations, and that values provide rigidity. But they also give one a ground to hold on steadfast in this rapid race for success. So, I may say that even though values may change, develop, or even differ from person to person, no one can deny their existence and that they are quintessential for our existence. Thank you.
Thank you, young lady. Just to add to that is that I think values Basically, I mean, I'm commenting on what you just said. Values are there, like I said right at the beginning, they exist, and values don't change. It's how we perceive, and whether we want to accept a value and make it and allow it to be a part of our lives, or we say to ourselves, no, I don't need to be thankful to people, I don't need to be obedient to people, I don't need to be respectful. But these are qualities which exist in society, and it is for us to either allow it to be a part of our lives or not. And what is happening today is that we tend to use different yardsticks. That appears to be changing from time to time. And that's why I suppose you say that, you know, somebody may look at a particular action and say, yes, that's perfectly acceptable, and someone else may look at it and say, sorry, that's not acceptable. It's that action is either right or wrong. It cannot be right to one and wrong to the other. It's either right or it's wrong. It's how we perceive it, depending on the yardsticks that we follow. Right. Any questions from... Come on, I'm sure you young students there will have some questions. Do I see your hand? Yes? Yes, please.
Yeah. If we follow one single value, automatically other values will come in order. Suppose I'm speaking truth. So if I want to speak truth, automatically I have to go from some other thing or in order. So what value should be given proper priority?
You're asking me, I assume.
I'm asking the
Yeah. Oh, you're asking the panelists. Okay, would anyone like to take that answer up? Okay. Yes, okay, that's nice. It's the young boy, come on.
Okay, so even what I want to say about values was pertaining to your question. I think everyone, it's not a question of when I believe in a certain value or not believe in a certain value. It's always a question of how much importance I give to one value over the other value. As you mentioned, if I am honest, all the other values come in that. But for a person, honesty would not be as important. To give you an example, if I know something about someone and I know that if I tell him that would make him sad. So there I have two options. I can either be honest and not kind by making him unhappy, or I can either be dishonest and kind by making him unhappy. So I have to choose what is more important for me. Is being honest more important, or is being kind more important? So that depends from person to person and his perception, what values are more important to him compared to the other values.
I can add
something. Oh, yes, sure.
Yeah. And there is a German philosopher, Max Scherer, who said, in fact, the first value for him is liberty, because this is a value which allows us to choose the other values.
Yeah, I think again, I mean, coming back, each one will look at a particular value as, you know, being most important to him or her. And to answer the question, is there any one particular value which will bring all values and you know, in together? Would be love? I mean, you know, if we learn to love, that's my way. I think if we can love our fellow beings, if we can love society, if we can love humanity, then we wouldn't have hatred, we wouldn't want to harm, we wouldn't want to tell lies, we wouldn't... that's my perception, that's my way of looking at it. I feel that if we can love people, then all other values, positive values, will naturally be exhibited. Yes, you want to add something to that? Of course, please, go ahead.
Love is necessary, but there is an antithesis and thesis to everything. So without hatred, love cannot exist, and without lie, truth cannot exist. So I may not say that I was just making my point that we should not restrict our vision of values. We should always pay attention and respect other values too. Just because those values are different from us, that's not necessary. They are wrong. They may be just different. So it's a gray area. So I won't think that there's a single value collectively correcting everything together in it. So we will have to sectionize everything and prioritize and make it what is more important to us, what we need in our scenario.
Well, thank you. I mean, that's an opinion and perfectly valid. I mean, if she's got an opinion, that's an opinion. May I now request Mr. Stefan Amelis to speak out his thoughts, and then we can go into questioning.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'm not sure it's a value, but it's certainly a very great quality, punctuality. And arriving on time, it's a very important, it's a basic politeness. So please accept all my apologies for being late and to delay all these events tonight. When Raoul asked me to address this very distinguished panel and even more distinguished audience, I wasn't sure, and I told him, well, I need to think about it. And I tried to remember what I did during my sociology and philosophy degree at the NCT, and there's one thing which always fascinated me. It's about the common values. It's about the Dr. Das mentioned that what we call the universal values, and do they exist or not? And if they do exist, are they changing now? Are they changing in a way that we need to build a new social contract? Is this a war? And I would say that the quality of today's war in comparison to the previous centuries is certainly a multicultural world. So this theme is maybe very French, but also I think it's not only French, it's the theme itself is universal, I think. In many societies, we live in a world which is more and more connected, and we have access, both passively and or actively, to ever greater quantity of information. And among this information, of course, in this flood of information, there is more and more values coming from the other side of the ocean, the other side of the land. And there is a range of, I would say, new values coming. So how these values, the values, they are different than the one which I grew up, and certainly even more different than the ones that my grandparents grew up today, nowadays. So this world maybe became a village, like Matt Lulan says, a global village. But there is a big contradiction. In a village, many people share almost the same values. In this world today, this connected world, what is the place of the universal values against the cultural values, I would say. I don't want to be too long, but maybe I will start by taking the devil's advocate's outfit and say, there is no universal values. There is no universal values, and believe me, for a Frenchman who has been fed on the milk of the French Revolution, the cornerstone of the French Republic nowadays, to say that liberty and equality are not universal, it's something, it's, I wouldn't say a sacrilege, but almost. But let's say it's a devil's advocate outfit. We can say that for these two things, even if they are not very old, the French Revolution is 200 and some years, 1789, but even now we can see that the interpretation varies from one country to another, and I would say to any individual to another. So the distinction can be written into a state's constitution, maybe, but I'm sure that even the young generation remember Nelson Mandela, who paid a very high price to fight for apartheid. And what about, of course, we have to remember, it was the name of liberty and progress that the European nations colonized so many other nations in the 19th century. Population, we certainly didn't ask for anything at the time. And whose culture was diminished or even destroyed. So the first point, yes, there is no international, no universal values. Why? Because there is a diversity of culture. Of course, to try to define universal values, we need a standard. I was mentioning the French Revolution. At the time, the French scientists managed to invent and impose some standards, the meter and the kilogram. But of course, they didn't, and nobody did manage to impose a standard for what is universal in any values. There's too many criteria entering in this definition. I don't want, I try to go directly so I'm not to buffer to you too much. So if there is one standard, and so I suppress the main part of the thing I wanted to say, if there is one standard, maybe it's a tautological one, tautological pleonasm, meaning that how can we measure the universal character of a value? Maybe a value, if it has to be universal, must concern the entire human species. Only then can humanity itself create standards for universal values. It's a big debate, and I'm sure that I will be happy to continue it, and I don't want to speak too much now. But, you know, these, I would say, not this fight, but these dialogues, but sometimes these hot dialogues between cultural values and universal values. Human rights, of course, we could have mentioned now the Declaration of Human Rights. Is liberty an international concept? But when it goes against tradition, what are the borders? Theoretically, men and women have the same rights all around the world. In France, it's not the case. We could give you many, many examples about it. So I just want to open this debate about traditional values, maybe, and universal values.
All right. Thank you so much. I think we've got a completely different perspective of the topic from our friend, Mr. Stéphane Amelir. And like he said, he spoke about, you know, the traditional values. Would anyone like to question him, or, you know, do you have any doubts, any clarifications? Anyone? Yes, please.
You talked about the universal values.
Yes.
So, what is the purpose of life, human life? Because that is the universal value. And the purpose of life, we must live. Now, today, rampant consumption. That should be restricted to 15-20%. The art, life, dance, music, and to be near the spirit. Live as we are made human being as a spirit. That should be having more value. So what do you think about this?
What you're describing, of course, I would say maybe individual values, but we are not the like Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the French philosopher from the Enlightenment, says man, when you say man, you mean, of course, human. Human is a social animals. So to pursue, of course, good quality of life, or the stories you are telling about this man, of course, but I think it has to be done in a society, in a group. And it's why I'm not sure that there is a universal individual values. When we speak about universal values, maybe we have a tendency of thinking of universal social values, but that's just maybe an idea.
I think coming back to the story that he's referring to is basically cherish every moment that we live. If we can learn to cherish every moment with clarity of thought, with complete purity of our mind, and I think, you know, to a large extent, we will be able to appreciate what life is all about. And speaking on what you just spoke about, you know, we live in a society. You know, yes, individually we all look to follow and inculcate our own values, but at the same time, because we belong to a society, we need to have shared values. And if we can all collectively have shared values, you know, as a society, we can then flourish. As a society, we can be happier. So individually, we learn to follow and inculcate our own values. However, at the same time, in a society, we must learn to be a part of the society by having shared values. Anyone else would like to say anything or ask any other questions? No, no one else. Okay.
I've got the questions here.
Yes, sure.
I would like really to address it because, you know, as a foreigner, you know, I've been here in Calcutta, of course, for a few years now. But I read newspapers, etc. And when I was thinking about this speech tonight, I thought about all the titles I read in the newspapers: the crime against women, the crime of honor, etc. And there are sometimes people say, no, there are our values too. So is there a contradiction? Somebody was speaking, one of the speakers was saying that, in the traditional values and the 21st century universal values. So I would like to ask this question.
Is anyone who can answer that? I mean, what exactly do you refer to when you talk about traditional values and values of the 21st century? Yes.
Whether it is traditional or modern value are the value. And there is no difference in that, because value will remain from the time immemorial. It is, as the Jesus Christ has said, not to do what you don't like to be done to you. So in our respective life, we have to see what we want to do. We have to be righteous, we have to be honest, we have to love, we do not hate, we do not be jealous. At least we counted this in the 20 items for which every individual has to strive and work for it. It is not the society alone or together, but each individual has to work together on this.
Yes, thank you. I think I said this right at the beginning that yes, values have always been there. They will be there. It's how we, whether we want to appreciate it or not. So honesty is honesty. Whether you go back to the Paleolithic age or you talk about the 21st century that we are living in, honesty will remain honesty. Obedience, respect, and so on will remain what it is. But I think, if I may, I think you are. Somebody mentioned it, and that's why you asked the question. Yeah, somebody mentioned about, the young lady. I think you need to, clarify this, because it was you who mentioned it. I think he's seeking the answer from you.
The question in the house is the present, the traditional values and the 21st century, how the values are changing. Well, as I said, change is impending, and well, there is an ongoing struggle between the present generation and the previous ones. There is a difference of values and difference of implementation of values. Even if the values are same, their implementations have changed. Well, we have seen when older values associated with joint families disintegrate, new ones come up, with us confining to other solidarities like our friends and colleagues. Various social norms being challenged, efficiency being chosen over hard work, and there are many other such things. We can't really choose a right or a wrong side here. So, well, we can say that values are changing, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. Well, being a Bengali and a proud Bengali, I would say that my parents and my grandparents used to visit their elders during this time of Vijayadashami and give them sweets, have sweets, and then take their blessing. But right now in this modern virtual world, we just send them a message, we send them a text, because everybody is very busy. So we can't just say that that's wrong, but we can't just ask them to get out their busy schedule where we don't get any holidays, so get out their schedule and come visit each and every relative. So what I think
that's the customs.
The
I think
values
you're talking
respecting. I don't think the implementation.
I think what you're referring to, young lady, is there are certain customs that we follow in a society.
I may have came out wrong.
Yeah, it's the customs that we which changes.
The main point here is the respect. The respect, the mode of respect differs.
Yes. The implementation respect, differs. Yeah. Sorry.
But the basic point, foundation is the respect to the elder. And that was, that exists earlier also and now also. Only the mode of showing the respect
has changed. The custom has changed, the ethics, that. Yes.
I think I would also like to amend a little bit.
Yeah, sure.
That is, as the he remembered a quote shown by Rahul. That is, it should be taken by heart. If you send by text, but it is in heart, there is no problem.
But if it is a customary, that you are just only making a duty and you are absent-minded for the regard and respect to the superior, that text has no meaning.
Yes, that's what I was saying.
That's all.
Okay. Right. Anyone else wants to offer any closing comments? Yes, young man.
As sir said, I don't think so. Values have changed. Values have always remained a change. It's the thought process of people which have changed today. And one thing I would also like to comment about is what Dr. Hart said. She said in a very wonderful way that today's schools have become a toll gate for financial success. I agree that today the competition has become intense in schools and the parents are forcing their child to work very hard, and they are like, I have a six-year-old cousin, he plays sports, like his mother forces him to play sports, dance, everything, and he's not even interested in many of the things, but he still does that. So I agree that this thing is there, but I do not agree that today's schools only motivate the student to go to a financial institution, work for financial success, because today's schools have various events, various exchange programs, various like MUNs, Modern United Nations, various programs which instill that thought process in the student, after which he thinks about the world, he thinks about the various events which is happening around the world, and that instills those kinds of thought process in the students. Also, as I mentioned, thought process of people are changing. For example, if I talk about my father, he was telling me that his grandfather did not allow my father to go into a profession which he wanted to go. But when I speak about myself, I wanted to be a pilot. I'm a private pilot. I'm going to my commercial pilot training. And my dad wonderfully allowed me to become a pilot. And being hailing from a Marwari family, he knew that if I enter the business, I would make more. But he told me that if you want to be a pilot, you can go ahead and be that. So this is a thought process which I want to tell you, that even if the competition becoming intense and schools are becoming like more and more concentrated, like competition becoming intense, people are also becoming more and more liberal. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. I think, we are about to close. To close this, I'd like to say, look, we face tough decisions almost every day. And some of us as parents, some of us as husbands, wives, in our professions, every day of our lives we are facing constantly, you know, tough decisions that we have to keep taking, and we encounter several circumstances which, you know, keep testing our patience, testing our character, testing our mood, and so on. And but ultimately we need to remember that it is values which will guide us. If we learn to accept them, these values will shape the priorities that we finally pick on, and it will help us to lead both a happier and maybe not just materialistic wealth, but you know, mental wealth. And that's what's important for us, to lead happier lives, not just as individuals, but as individuals living in society. Thank you so much. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, gentlemen. I think you've done the topic proud. You've done yourselves proud with what you had to, you know, elucidate with the topic. Thank you so much for being such a wonderful audience. And I'm sorry that we've had to close a little late, but you know, there's no harm in being a little late when you are discussing something as important as values. Thank you very much.
Late, and it's a very privileged affairs that when you give vote of thanks, most of the chairs get empty. But thanks for the speaker for giving valuable discourses on values. It is invaluable. I will only quote one thing. Let us take it in heart and disperse. Thank you.